Chassid Bava Metzia, we're going to study today the fascinating daf of 106. We'll start at the Mishnah in 105b, Hamekabel, one who received. So the previous perek, the previous chapter, is Hashoel, one who asked, right? And this one is Hamekabel, meaning one who received. So we're going to study today in 106 the power, the Koach HaTfilah, the power of our prayer. Not long ago, visited a family, husband, wife, and they complain about the son who is in a very bad physical condition. They ask to make a special prayer for him. So naively, the fellow, which is used to be the gabbai here, asked them, what's the name of that son? And guess what's the name of the son? I bet that no one here will know. The name of the son is Esav. Was geared? True story, Esav. So the fellow asked them, why Esav? So she said, what do you mean? We are traditional and we learn the Torah and we open the Torah portion and we have a twin boys. And my name is Rivka, my husband's name is Yitzchak, and we have a twin boys. So we call one son Esav, and another son Yaakov. So now Esav is in a bad condition. He's in a hospital. And I want you to go to the synagogue and make a prayer for him. So he came and asked this question. He said, so what should we do now? She says, oh, we are not like you. We don't think that negative things. It's a Bible. It's a Tanakh. It's a Parshat Toldot. It was the Parshat they were born. They are twin. So what's the problem? We don't mend the ancient one. We figure out if Yitzchak and Rivka originally called the names of their children that names, so it's okay that we call our sons in these names. Now the truth is, there is a book, fascinating book. It's called Chishukei Chemed. I wish to have it in English. But he dealt with this type of question and he have some solutions. He said that you can, when you do the Mishaberach, so you can change the name, add the name. V'ikore Shmo B'Yisrael, pick a name. Binyamin Ben Rivka. That's it. Instead of Esav ben Rivka, Binyamin ben Rivka. But the subject of the power of our prayer is going to be a serious subject we're going to talk today. It's a matter of fact, if you look at this beautiful Mishnah, we're going to study in page 105b, it's a very logical, just a word of introduction. We learn three concepts in this chapter, in this perek. We learn the concept of kablanut. Kablanut in a sense, or arisut, it's like a sharecropper. So in that sense, the sharecropper pay the owner according to the yevul of the karka, whatever the profit, the benefit of the land, that's what he's going to pay. That's one concept. Then we learn the concept of chachiruta, which is chochel. Chochel is basically a person in that sense of a tenant. But the difference is that is a fixed price, meaning he paid him a fixed price. So for example, he gives him from the produce of the field 500 pounds in a fixed amount of price. Then we have the regular schirut, the regular tenant. The regular tenant pays, instead of produce, fruits, he paid cash with money. So what's the real difference between chocher and socher? Between one that used the fruits as a produce, payment with the produce, one who used money? The answer is, if we learn the previous daf, it was makat medina, original crisis. All of a sudden, God forbid, hurricane, tsunami, earthquake, something that happened to everybody, crisis. Those Israelis remember those years that all of a sudden you have the missiles that came from north. Tafshin Samech Vav. You remember that? So basically people from the north went to the center of Israel to save their lives. They're afraid to... So in that time, the one who is basically in that category, Chacharanuta, so you pay in the produce, there is no produce. Why? Because it's a regional crisis. So that's the difference. Versus the one who used the pay cash, then he paid cash. So now, let's get the framework of this perek. It's very structural. And Shia, you can write it down because it's very structural. You like things in a very structural way, so you have it. The first and the second Mishnayos in this perek, dealing with both Chachirut and Arisut, which means the sharecropper and tenant. That's the first two Mishnayos, right? Then the Mishnah number three, which we study on page Kuf Dalet Amud Aleph, page 104a, dealing solely and only in Arisut, only in sharecropper. Then we have the Mishnah number four, that it was in Kufhei Amud Aleph, the previous Shiur, that dealt solely with Chocher, solely with the person that pay with produce. Then we have Mishnah number five, that's going to back to Arisut, meaning a person that is a sharecropper. Now let's think logically. If the first two Mishnayos dealing with both, and then Mishnah number three dealing with what? With Arisut. Mishnah number four dealing with Chocher. Mishnah number five dealing with Arisut. So then Mishnah number six, that the Mishnah we're going to study, it has to be about what? Chocher, about someone who has a fixed price that is going to pay what the with the produce, which is this perek in particular is very structural perek. So what we have here? We have a Mishnah dealing with ones, something that happened to a field beyond the person's anticipation. So here we are, the Mishnah, it's seven lines from bottom of the page 105b. Hamkabel sadeh mechavero v'achalak chagav o nishdefa. So someone who receives a field from another to cultivate the field. So for example, is a yearly lease with a payment of fixed payment of 500 pounds in exchange. But unfortunately, crisis befall it. It is either a grasshopper's consume it, or there's a tremendous wine. Nishdefa shidafon is wine blasted. Wine blasted, if you remember when we study Parshat Ki Tavo in the book of Dvarim, there is a fascinating Rashi. You see it also in Bereshit Mem Aleph. Rashi said, Ruach Kadim, Ruach Mizrachit, which is a very strong wind that basically disconnected, nitka et achita me'afar, disconnected the wheat, and as a result, hagarinim afu, the seeds disappear. So the Mishnah said, imakat medinai, if it's a regional crisis, the regional disaster that affected all the field in the area, which is not only your field damage, but these grasshoppers or this strong wind, eastern wind, consume others as well. Menakelo mincha choro. So he is basically subtract from the produce he owes as part of his tendency. According to the Rambam said, according to the amount that he lost. Now, the reason, it's because Tosfot said that at that very moment, his field cannot produce much. Now, the language excuse me, of the Rambam, and you see it also in Shulchan Aruch Choshen Mishpat 3:22, is the Taina, the claim that Mazalo Garim, is bad luck caused it, it's a one of those debates if this is real or not. And the way that the Beit Din evaluated it is by looking at the general regional situation. Now, Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Im Kibla Heimenu. If all of that applies, if he received the field, which is the deal with the produce, but if Kibla Heimenu Bema'ot, if it's a deal with cash payment, which is the payment for using the tendency is cash and not paying with the produce from the field, Bein kach, uvein kach, eino menakel omechachoro. Regardless, he is not subtract the produce he owes part of his tendency. Rashi said, Amar lo mazalcha garam, meaning bad luck. There's nothing we can do. It's bad luck, and that's the way it is. Now, the Gemara have a discussion here. What exactly the definition of regional disaster? Hey chedamei makat medina. What exactly you meant when you used this term, regional disaster? So they said, what is it? Amar Rav Yehuda kegon de ishaduf ruba de vagna. Here, we talk about Shidafon, when the most of the valley in which the field located was wind blasted, so it's considered a regional disaster. That's the way Rashi explained. So it's basically the bad muzzle of that fellow. Ula amar kegon shenishtadefu arba sadot me'arba ruchotea. He said the example is, for example, if the four fields were wind blasted in the four sides. Amar ula ba'u b'ma'arava, in Eretz Yisrael, nishdaf telem echad al pnei kula mai. If that blast happened to be in four different fields, but only shura achat nishdefa, only one line is damaged. So, the Gemara in Sanhedrin, Mephoshim said, it's a famous Gemara that said, Rabbi Yoshua ben Hananiah, they throw him to the furnace. So they said that part of him was burned. So they said, how come? So they explained, unlike Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, that they were sent by Nebuchadnezzar to the furnace, but they're all righteous. Here, Rabbi Yoshua ben Hananiah went with other people who are not. But the derivative here is he used the term, telem echad al pnei kula. One pharaoh was wind blessed among its entire length. Mai, nishtayer telem echad al pnei kula mau, afsika bira mai, aspasta. So the question is, if one pharaoh remained undamaged along the entire length, how you treat it off, if a fallow field divided between the cultivated fields and the fields that were wind blasted, what's the halakha? Or if there is a field of a father between the field and another that were wind blasted. Page 106, my, what exactly the halakha? Do you say that since all around field will not take part of that shidafon, or that crisis of blast, so it's not considered as a regional crisis, the regional disaster, or you may say that this fellow who leases, the tenant or the one who paid the rent, he can claim that if those fields were field of crop that people can use as a human consumption, they were also being lost in that wind blast, so therefore it's considered a regional disaster. And even if we said that around that field, it's not part of the crisis and it's not considered a regional disaster, since you tell me that that's applied to those fields that planted with wheat and not the one who have fodder, still you have a question about the four fields around. Why? Zera acher mai. If it's a different type of seed, what's the halacha? Do you say that only the one who have the father, that's the one that it's good only for animal consumption, but others not? Chitei legabei seorim kezera acher damei ola. If you treated a wheat in relation to barley, it's considered like a different type of seed or not? Furthermore, kol haolam kulo b'shidafon v'shelo b'yeirakon. So everyone else, the entire surrounding field is bleached with wind blasts, and his was affected by mildew. So it's a different crisis, different type of crisis. So here the Meiri emphasized that according to Rav Yehuda, we talk about the majority of the field around that valley. But according to Ula, it's the four fields around his field. Iname kol ha'olam kulo irakon v'shelo b'shidafon, or the vice versa, the entire world stuck by mildew and his is a wind blast. So the Gemara said, Teiko, Eliyahu Anavi, is Tishbi, Yataretz, Kushiyot v'Ibayot, they left it open. So the Shulchan Aruch in Choshen Mishpat, the 322 said, since the halacha is according with the opinion of Rav Yehuda, not of the Ula, none of these dilemmas have practical applications. Amar lei zar'e hachitei, ve'azal hu uzra'a sa'arei. So he was asked to do wheat, and he did barley instead. Ruba devagana, ruva devaga, ve'ishtaduf namehach sa'arei dilei. Mai, so most of that valley was with that wind blasts, but it's also this field with barley of his were also wind blasts. So how you treated? What's the halacha? Mi amrinan de amar leilu zarat achite da hava nam mishtad faudin mamatze amar leilu zarat achite hava mekayim v'tigzar omer v'yakam lach, which is whatever Eov asked from Hashem happened. So I did not ask at the beginning of the year that your Almighty help me with the barley, only with the wheat. So it means if he planted wheat, it means that it's a possibility that his will be successful, even the other field were not. That's the pasuk they said, Ve'al drachecha nagaho. So we learn here from the value, the koach of tefillah, as we said in the introduction, that they don't underestimate the power of your prayer. Mistabra de amrlei, the Gemara said it's more rational to say that the owner of the field said to the tenant, Izra'ata chitei hava mekayem bi, v'tigzar omer v'yakom lach v'al darchecha naga o. So he said it's more reason to say, the owner can say to him, had you planted with wheat, would have filled for me this pasuk, and you shall decree a matter, and it will be established for you, and the light shall shine upon your ways. So that's the pasuk in Iyov chapter 22. Even the other fields have this terrible crisis of blast, mine will be saved because of the prayer. So since the tenant cannot prove that it wasn't in his to him to blame, so therefore he cannot subtract from the payment. That's the way Nemuke Yosef explained. Another question: Nishtadefu kol sdotav shel machkir, if the field of the owner of the land were wind blasted, v'ishtaduf name ha'abadayu, and this one was also wind blasts with them. Velo ishtaduf ruba devaga mai, and this one were also wind blast with them, but the majority of the valley was not wind blast. So how you, what's the halacha? Mi amrena kivan delo ishtaduf ruba devaga lo menakelei. Do you say that since the majority of the valley was not wind blast, So the tenant farmer does not subtract from the owner amount that he owe. Or Dilma Kevan de Ishtaduf Kul Hu Ar Ate. Since all the lands of the owner were wind blasted, the tenant can say to the owner, Matze Amar Le Mishum Latach Didachu. So it's happened due to your bad fortune, bad mazel. The Hamishtadelfu calls Dotecha, because that happened to the entire field, and therefore we want to subtract from the payment. So the Gemara said, Mistabra de Amale Mishum Latachu said that it's more rational to say that it's a bad fortune. The Ha Amai. Why? Hachaname Amarle Mishum Latai Mishum Latai Dideyu Ham Mishar Leputa Dave Mikaim Bikin Nisharnu Meat Me'arbe Few of Many Mishum Damarle Yave Chazit Lishtayur Lachmidei Have Mishtay Lach Benavshei. Had you been worthy of something being left for you, it would have been left from your own private land, not the field you pay to cultivate. Now, there is a Tosfot in Megillah, Yud Bet. It's a famous teshuva from the late Rav Yosef Shalom Elyoshiv, we talk about names, and we talk about the value of the names. So the Tosfot said in Megillah about Ephron. It was a Rava that his father was name is Ephron, and because Ephron was a Rosha, right? You know the story of Abraham Avinu, and how he sold him the land, the Baras HaMachpelah, right? So Tosfot over there in Megillat Yud Bet, Megillah 12 said, so they call him Rava, the son of Ophran. They changed the name from Ephron to Ophran. Shem Reshoim Yirkav. So Rabbi Yoshev extrapolated and he said, even the name of that Ephron, the father of Rabba was not the Ephron in the Pasuk, in the Mikra. But since they have it resonates, the idea of Shem Reshoim Yirkav, so therefore they changed the name to different way, to Orphan. But Tosfot here also elaborate on the concept. And he said that if he said, "Harei ani mochel lecha la chazara," if I forgive you for return, so you're left with nothing. So the whole idea here, the Tosfot said that the reason he needs to pay him is because you see a kind of sign from heaven that. It happened for a reason, but the whole claim is based on that understanding. Who is guilty and how? If this is really, in a way, nature disaster, or it's something that is a person responsible for that. But what we see earlier on page Kufhe Amud Bet, 105b, is the machloket, is the disputation between Rav Yehuda and Ula. What exactly the definition of the original disaster? But both of them agree upon that if it's the valley, the field of the valley, and it was a wind blast, it's considered as a original disaster, even not everyone's damaged for that. So the Gemara asks Meitivei. We learn it's very similar to the Mishnah in Erkin 29, Sdeh Achuza. A person that inherited a land from his ancestors, who inherited from the time of the dividing the land of Yehoshua bin Nun, the early Tanakh time. So if a person sell that estate, he cannot have a permanent sale because they have the Jubilee, only the 49, when it's reached that time, it's returned. Early than time, that he can redeem that field. Haita shnat shidafon veyerakon o shvi'it. So if during that time it was a year of wind blasted crop or mildews, or it was a sabbatical year, o shayu shanim kishnei Eliyahu, So those years that we all know that in the book of Kings, chapter 17, 18, it wasn't rain. So he said, "Eino lelo min haminyan," do not count as part of his years before he may repurchase his land. And the Gemara explained, "Ktane shidafon veirakon dumi yedushlem gishne Eliyahu." Ma shne Eliyahu do lav v'tvoa klal, the same way as those years of Elijah. It wasn't any produce at all. Afar ha-chanami, do lav v'tvoa klal. Aval di katvoa sal kalei. We don't say that it is a regional disaster. Omar Rav Nachman Bar Yitzchak, Shana Yatam Damar Kram Nispar Shnei Tvotim Kolach. Shanim Shesh Ben Tvua Baolam. This applies to years that there is a produce harvested in the world. Amar Rav Ashi Rav Kana, La Me'ata Shvi'it Ta'alelu Min HaMinyan. The sabbatical year should be a part of the two. The Ayik Tvua. Bechutz la'aretz, that is a produce outside of Eretz Israel. So why the Brayta said that the sabbatical year is not counted in the years? So he said, Amar lei shvi'it afkada de malkahi. The sabbatical year is the Almighty. It should not be included in the number of years before the land is repurchased. It's like, Hashem abrogated the sabbatical year from any form of planting in Eretz Israel. Since it's prohibited to do any form of planting, it's like not existed that year, and is not counted as the year of those 2 years, but if it's a year that they have a regional disaster, that year is befitting for a planting. Only that place, unfortunately, they don't have any produce. So therefore, we consider this a Shnat Tvua, and we counted this a part of the years. The whole idea of Sde Achuza, according to Rat Chaim and others, that's only applied to Eretz Israel. The Raived, Ishtam Kubetzet, and others said it. So Amar Lemarzut Rabed Ramer Ravina, Ela Me'ata Shvi'it Lo Talelo Min HaGeirua. So if that's the case, when it comes to sabbatical year, you should not count him from the deduction of the price of the field when it's redeemed. Alama Tnan, why? Because we learn in the Mishnah in Tractate Erkin, page 25, that the one who consecrated his field gives Sela Upundeyon Leshana, which is a coin that's worth 16 prutot to the Beit HaMikdash treasury for each year remaining until the Jubilee year, including the sabbatical year. That's basically the way that they make the payment. The Torah described in Leviticus 27. The amount to be paid per year, which is 50 shekels divided by the years remaining until the Jubilee year, should not take the upcoming sabbatical year into account. So he said, Amar lei, shane'atam dechazia lemishtecha bei pirei. So he said, over there it's different. Why? Because as it's suitable for laying out produce on it. So although one may not plant the field during the sabbatical year, one may use it for other purposes. That's the idea of Shnei Tvuot. The Halacha, the Rambam said in the Hilchot Shmita v'Yovel, chapter 11, a field cannot be redeemed prior to the passage of 2 years. If the field was wind blasted or suffer from mildew one of the years, or if one of the years was a sabbatical year, the year is discounted. So Amar Shmuel, so now the Gemara circumscribed the din of the Mishnah. We said that it is a reduction when it's a regional disaster. Amar Shmuel, lo shanu ela shezra'a v'tzamcha ve'achala chagav. Here, you know what we talk? It's a special situation that this Makat Medina, original disaster, the cultivator subtract from the produce he owes as part of his tenancy, only part of his rent, only if the tenant planted the field and it sprouted and then grasshopper consumed it. Or if it planted with a different seed, but he did not plant it at all. So here, the tenant is not entitled to subtract from the amount he owes even if there was a regional disaster. לא שאנו שזרה וצמחה וחלק על חגב, אבל עוזרה כלל, לא. ואמר לי, אם לא עוזרה אתה, ומקיים לו יבוש ומת רע, ומת אבון יסבר. So therefore, he's not subtracting. מה תיב רב שישת, רואה שהיה רואה, here you have a shepherd that was herding the animal of other people, והניח עדו ובא לעיר, this fellow was disrespondable, he left his flock, and he came to town. So obviously, guys, what happened? ובא זאב וטרף. It's a fox came in and he basically attacked the animal and he tore an animal to pieces. Or a rivedaras, or is a lion came and trampled one of the flock. אין אומרים אילו היה שם היה מציל. We don't say if the shepherd was there, he will save the animal. אלא עומדין אותו אם יכול להציל חייו, אם לאו פטור. We just evaluate if he could have rescued his animal by chasing a beast of this kind of way. So he's liable because his departure from the scene, so that's contributing factor to the damage. But if not, he's exempt. It's like the typical shepherd at Patur Me'ones. It's like the same as the Shomer Sachar, the same as a guardian, paid guardian. So it's Patur or Ones. We need to prove it. If it's a Pshia, if it's a negligent or Ones. ועמי, what's the rationale to say that he's exempt? נעמלי, אבי את התמה ומקיים גם את הארי וגם את הדור ויקאיו דרך. That's what דוד המלך said. You can say the same here. If he was present, it's different. Those who involve in security business will tell you that sometimes avoiding terrorism, which unfortunately the world facing day in and day out, we pray, by the way, for all these people in Yerushalayim today. You heard about it, that it's, the truck came in and hits the soldiers and, if I'm not mistaken, killed 4 and wounded 15. Horrible. So anyway, for terrorism, some experts will tell you that just by having present security people, that's already create an atmosphere of trepidation, of fear, and people think twice before doing something. So in that sense, this is the claim that, look, it can be potentially saved from the grasshoppers, or this attack of a beast animal, if you, a shepherd, was there. So here, why is not the owner of the animals, why cannot make the same claim as the one who leased the farmer land? So they said, משום דאמר לי, אבית חזל התרחו של הכניסה, אבית רחש להכניסה כרבי חנל בן דוסה. If you are entitled to a worthy of miracle according to you, a miracle could have included to you the same as famous Rabbi Chanan ben Dosa. The Matian is a dube bekarnayu. There's a famous story that today when these goats brought bears impaled by their horns without any assistance of the part of the shepherd. So it means that without the presence, the miracle happened. There's a famous story in the Gemara in Tani 25. The main neighbor of Rabbi Chanan ben Dosa complained that his goats create damage to their field. So Rabbi Chanan ben Dosa said that if it's true, the bear will eat his goats, but otherwise every one of them should bring that evening a bear in the horn, and that happened. ונעים אלי נעיל דניסה לרבה לא אבי חזינה, לניסה זוטה, maybe as far as the great miracle, so he's not worthy. But how about the small miracle, which is that saving from the fox, from the lion? Page 106b, Chazena, I'm worthy. So the Gemara conclude, Kashia, it's difficult. Tana echad, הפעם ראשונה ושנייה זורה. ושלישית אינו זורה. ותן יעידך שלישית זורה רביעית אינו זורה. So how come? This is a contradicted brightot. לא קשיא עקירה ביה עקירה בן שמעון בן גמליאל. So it's a totally different avenue. They say, it's Gemara in Yevamah 64b, and they have this disputation between the father of Rabban Shimon Gamliel with Rebbe. So that's the story of a woman that the husband passed away. It's a disputation when exactly the woman is considered katlanit, because she's then prohibited to get married. So according to Rebbe, it's even two times. Rabban Shimon Gamliel said that only three times, so he allowed her to marry third time. as again, the question is if there's just a force of circumstance or is there really something that be concerned. So again, that's the disputation. So we try to juxtapose to hear Lokashia, Hakirabe, Hakiraban Shimon Gamliel. So the first bride that followed the Rebbe, which is 2 years, the other one followed Rabban Shimon Gamliel, was 3. Hakirabi Damar betrays Zimna Ave Chazoke, Rabban Shimon Gamliel, it loves Zimna Ave Chazoke. So the difference is, if you go by the Rebbe, it's 2 times, it's already considered as a presumptive status. Rabban Shimon Gamliel, he says 3 times. It's a established a presumptive status, and there have to be a 3 occasions. You talk about the fellow that he planted the field and sprouted, and locusts consume the crops. However, aval zra velo samcha, if he planted and nothing happened, there's no field, no growth. Said to him, you should continue planting it on all the days that are fit for planting. Vademat. So, how far you ask? Until when the period of planting lasts? Omar Rav Papa de Asu Arisa Midabra, Vekaima Kima Areshayu. So that's talking a little bit about Mazalot, but the idea is until such time when the sharecroppers come in the field and start the idea of Mazal Taleh, the star Kima, is over the heads, which occur roughly during the month of Teivet, until the month of Adar. Meitivei, so now the Gemara challenge this answer. They say in the Torah in Bereishit, chapter 8, that after the great flood, Rabbeinu Shalom promised to Noah, it will be always 6 period of the year. Rabban Shimon ben Yishuv omer v'chen, Rabban Shimon ben Menasseh omer kidvarav, chatzi tishrei mar cheshvan v'chatzi kislev zera, chatzi kislev tevet v'chatzi shvat chorev, chatzi shvat adar v'chatzi nisan kor, chatzi nisan iyar v'chatzi sivan katzir, chatzi sivan tamuz v'chatzi av kaitz, chatzi av elul v'chatzi tishrei chom, Rabbi Yehuda mone mitishrei, Rabbi Shimon mone mar cheshvan. I wish to have more time, so that's a long sugya. You see more in Rosh Hashanah, but it's a long sugya how we go by this counting of the mazalot. Man mekei bekulu, Rabbi Shimon, bekulu ha eloka. Amar lo kashya ha dekabla minei becharfei, ha dekabla minei beaflei. Rabbi Yehuda אומר, אם כי לא ממנו במהות, הוא גבר דקבל הרי למזרע והוא תומי, אגודה דנער אמר כסבא בזוזי, הסתכר נער אמר כסבא, עד לקמי דרע ואמר לי, נער אמר כסבא לא אבי דמיסקר, מכת נדנה איזיל, נקלי, אמרו לי רבונו לרב, הענן תנן רבי יהודה אומר, אם קיבלה ממנו במאות בין כך ובין כך, אינו מנקל או מנחה חורו. אמר להו, רב הסד, לית דחוש לה לית רבי יהודה. We'd like to conclude with something from Agra de Pirka. The Bnei Yisachar, the famous commentary in the Torah, teaches us a fascinating lesson from this daf. It seems from the Gemara that the land yields less or more in accordance to how much chokhmah the generation has. So here the question is, how far you go without chokhmah? So they said, we learned from my great-grandfather, Rabbi Tzvi Hirsch of Tzidichoyv. So it's a dispute among the tzaddikim regarding to how one should daven. It was often said by many tzaddikim, and especially Rabbi Tzvi Hirsch of Tzidichoyv, my great-grandfather, that one can pray that a particular thing should happen to solve a problem. He will explain the verse, Kaveh, hope to Hashem, and give Hashem kav, a direction, so to speak. If one thinks that the deliverance will best come in a particular manner, he can beg Hashem to do this if he wants. Other tzaddikim disagrees. They will say, do we serve a God who requires our input to find the best way? Hashem surely does not require our advice. Our sole point in prayer should be to ask God for help, not to offer God guidance. But it appears from the Gemara here in Bava Metzia 106 that the first approach is correct. There we find a case of one who hired someone to plant wheat and the sharecropper planted barley. even if the field was washed away, the owner can claim the Almighty answers that what a person prayer for, or, and I ask for wheat. If I pray for success of what you planted, no destruction will fall in my field. So this is basically the halacha. You see it in Choshen Mishpat 3:22. We see that the Almighty grants, and just use the text here, the Almighty grant person's request even if one gives a cow. So but the other approach will disagree with this proof. They will explain that although it is better to just ask without specifying, in that case the person happened to ask about wheat, and so the Almighty did what he asked. Nevertheless, the best thing is not to determine in the prayer how Hashem will give him bounty. Rather, it is best to simply pray to have parnasa, to have an income, and therefore Hashem will grant it what is the best for a person.